Hi everybody, thank you very much for taking the time to stop during what is a really busy day, I'm sure, for you to listen to me speak on the topic of fibre fragmentation. What if I told you that the textiles we wear and produce negatively impact the environment, regardless of where they come from, and consequently it's only through collective action that we can address it? Over the next 30 minutes or so, I hope to convince you of my reasoning. I'll frame the problem, introduce you to the Microfibre Consortium, discuss the latest science that supports my claim, and tell you what actions you can take to mitigate the problem. What are fibre fragments? And just to pick up on Charles's point earlier, that we are called the Microfibre Consortium, yes, we are talking about fibre fragmentation. Microfibres are fragments of textile fibres that are released from textiles into the environment from the textile itself. If they are released from synthetic textiles such as polyester, they can also be referred to as microplastics. But all types of fibres can shed from a textile, and therefore the issue is not isolated to plastics alone. Of course, in the textile industry, I'm sure you are aware, microfibre is a very specific type of fibre that is referred to, or it means a very fine fibre, for example, those that are used in microfibre cloths. When we talk about microfibres in the context of microfibre pollution, we are not referring to those very specific types of fibre, we are referring to all textile fibres. And it's because of that, the Microfibre Consortium prefer to use the term, following lots of consultation within the industry, fibre fragment, and the process of fibre fragmentation, those fibres being lost from the textile. Fibre fragments that are found in the environment come from the textiles that we make. The clothes, from the clothes that we wear through to the fabrics that we use within our homes and the places of work as furnishings. Regardless of the fabric, it has the propensity to shed fibres, some just to a greater extent than others, and this includes natural fibres. We often get asked the topic of and get drawn into microplastics versus microfibres and natural fibres versus synthetic fibres. My question to you is, would you consider a fibre to be natural if they've been laced with chemical dyes and chemical finishes? The environment doesn't consider them to be natural. To the environment, they're no different from synthetic fibres. They're pervasive. In studies that look to analyse all types of fibre fragments that are found within whatever given environmental environment they look for, approximately 60 to 70% of them originally from natural sources, and they are all coloured, which means they've been dyed. We also know the fibres are released throughout different stages, from manufacture, through the use stage, and also during end of use. So throughout the whole life cycle, a textile has the propensity to lose fibres and release them to the environment. Wherever scientists look for fibre fragments, they find them. Oceans, rivers, lakes, mountains, within animal species, and now almost what seems like every part of the human body. And once they are lost from a textile and released into the environment through the pathways of air, water or land, they then have the potential to harm the environment, wildlife and people. And research continues to emerge on the negative effects of their physical and or toxicological presence in our ecosystems. And today, evidence shows that fibre fragments also threaten to exacerbate three interlinked issues: pollution, biodiversity loss, and climate change. which is known as the triple planetary crisis. So who are TMC, the Microfibre Consortium? We are a non-profit science-led organisation with a vision to work towards zero impact from fibre fragmentation from textiles to the natural environment. We work to connect and translate deep academic research with the reality of commercial supply chain production. We are driven by research with industry change at our core. And we address the issue of fibre fragmentation by convening the global textile sector to limit fibre fragmentation and microfibre pollution. And we operate through a holistic approach of interventions both in design and development and also in manufacturing to create change for the whole product lifestyle. Within design and development, our approach is to influence root cause change. And we do that through understanding the drivers of fibre fragmentation through fabric testing. And that root cause understanding, which we can make, helps us to develop practical solutions that can address the problem at its source, which is the textile itself. You'll hear, as Charles said later on, from James Hill next and also from Mark, I'm sure, Mark Taylor, when he speaks, about the testing that we do to understand that root cause understanding. So I will leave that for them to describe in greater detail. Within manufacturing, we align guidance across the sector to ensure clear and measurable action on managing fibre loss and reducing production through improvements in manufacturing processes and wastewater management. And we are currently working in collaboration with ZDHC to develop quantitative test methods to measure loss of fibres into wastewater streams. We work through three pillars. They are to align, understand and mitigate. We want to align the industry, we want to understand what's happening at source, and we want to use that to mitigate pollution to the environment. We are now at a stage where, where our understanding has grown from where we started back in 2016, when fibre fragmentation was a really nascent issue and as a result had limited integration into established sustainability strategies. It was largely, and still remains actually, an invisible pollutant, but there was a lack back then of quantitative data to substantiate either the scale of the upstream problem or the upstream cause or the downstream impact to the environment. And so to date, we have worked with stakeholders to engage them on the issue, and it's been very much a standalone topic whilst the research continued to emerge. We are now in 2024. And we are now at a place where we want to align and support, where we see there's much confusion across the industry of how and where to place fibre fragmentation as a topic. We are moving into the stage of implementation in our work, and we want to move from a siloed topic to one that is integrated within the larger sustainability agenda. We want to focus our research that supports that larger agenda and really help to find entry points for organisation on what they want to work on as the topic. But one that doesn't really sit within their agenda or as they see it at the moment. And that is only through a cross-industry collaboration can we achieve that. TMC's position of fibre fragmentation today is that it's one of an integral part of biodiversity, environmental pollution and climate strategies. We have increased understanding and alignment, and that is supported by the scaling of data that we have through our testing and understanding of root causes from that material testing and data, and the scientific rigor that it brings, which we didn't have before. And it's evident now that the topic requires mainstream attention and urgent action through material strategies. It's critical that the industry embraces the scientific evidence that is out there of the multifaceted risks posed by fibre fragmentation. The next step is really to mobilise a no-regrets approach, one of TMC's mantras, meaning that fibre fragmentation mitigation actions do not detriment material performance and cause additional environmental impact areas to be negatively or more negatively affected. And that really starts with understanding how the issue is intrinsically connected to those three impact areas of biodiversity loss, environmental pollution, and climate change. And it's quite clear the earlier down the chain that we can influence change, the less impact they will have later down the line. If we look at this in a more visual way, we've taken our existing infographic, which is the colourful one on the left-hand side, and we've integrated it into a much larger agenda, where we can start to connect the materials with the impact that they are having. If we start at the fabric level, which is the foundation of TMC's work, we can see around that wheel the different influencing factors that are the root causes to why a material sheds to the extent that it does. We know through the research and the scaling data through the testing that TMC has done that there are many factors to influence a fabric shedding: the composition, the fibres and yarns, the coloration processes that are used, to name but a few. And we understand now that that goes to a much deeper level. And we know we can change that through our research and development that we've seen of materials. So understanding that root cause helps us to do that. And we also know that we can change manufacturing in terms of how efficient a plant is and how it's processed through the supply chain to also reduce pollution. So it's clear that action can be taken that will influence change. Pathways are becoming increasingly important to connect the materials to the impact that they are having. You heard this in the earlier slide, and it's becoming more important as we understand more that it's not just connected to water, but it's also through pathways of air and land. When this work first started, it was very much related to water, as marine biologists were finding microplastics, that we now know are just microfibers, in aquatic environments, and that being led directly back to the washing of our clothing. So that's where the issue started and where most of the focus was. But as we understand it now, we know the importance of those other pathways that increases the scale of the issue, which we'll talk about a little bit later. And the research that is currently emerging demonstrates the growing evidence of the connection between this topic and these three areas of impact. And we know through those various pathways that we're detrimentally impacting the environment for fibre fragments as a pollutant, which also then affects biodiversity and consequently climate change. And that is through two ways: through the physical effect of their presence, and also the toxicological effect that they're having when they reach their end destination in the environment. And there is growing scientific evidence to demonstrate that they are accumulating in aquatic, terrestrial, and airborne environments, and their negative impact that they're having on those ecosystems and organisms. So let's delve into the science a little bit. Now, of course, I can't go through all of this in the short time we have, but let me just give you a little bit of a flavour of what evidence is out there. And let's start with environmental pollution. By environmental pollution, what we mean is the introduction of harmful substances into the natural environment. And we've just mentioned, or I just mentioned, that in turn, the effects of that will have on biodiversity and climate. But when we're talking about pollution of fibre fragments, what we're talking about is the sources and pathways to the environment and also their potential threat to humans. We have already mentioned that fibres can be released from textiles, both natural and synthetic, and throughout the whole of the product life cycle. We know that when they are laundered by consumers, microfibres are generated in the wash and they enter the wastewater. We know that millions of microfibres are generated from each wash. And we know that wastewater treatment plants can filter some of these out. Some plants offer even up to 90% efficiency, but due to the extremely high numbers that are going through those systems, there's still millions of fibres that are released. That's coupled with the fact that only about 20% of global wastewater is treated by wastewater treatment plants. And the estimations from the scientific work is that approximately 6.5 million tonnes of microfibres are released globally through this pathway. But if we talk about wastewater, then we also have to consider sludge. So even if the fibres are captured from the wastewater, they often become part of sludge fertiliser, which is then spread on the land and offers another pathway to the environment. If we talk about the release of microfibres during laundry, where most of the research has been focused, what about also through drying, particularly through tumble drying? During a 15-minute tumble drying cycle, over 500,000 fibres can be released into the air. That is being thought to be on par with that of a wash. As the fibres are, or the fabrics are disposed of at their end of use stage, as the larger fibres break down into smaller fibre fragments over time, again, they enter the environment. At this stage, the focus of the environmental pollution research is to really understand which of the pathways has a greater effect. So we're not really sure at the moment how they compare to each other, but we do know, and the scientific evidence is there, that all three are an issue. That pollution then in turn affects biodiversity, which is the level of variety of life on Earth or within an ecosystem, be that animals, plants, fungi, or organisms such as bacteria. And it's essential for healthy ecosystems that we have biodiversity because we rely on that for food and for clean water. And biodiversity can be affected by any process which causes long-term harm to species or the ecosystems that we live in. So in terms of fibre fragmentation, when we talk about biodiversity loss, we're considering what effect do microfibres in the environment have on the health of species. Well, to date, they have been found in over 200 species that have been tested. Pretty much every species that has been tested, both in marine and terrestrial environments, have microfibres been found. Their effects, whether again, natural or synthetic, can be physical, such as through the blockage of digestive systems or the irritation of lungs, through chemical effects of the leaching of chemicals from the microfibres, and that comes back to coloration and the addition of chemical additives, or biological as a result of transport of pathogens or microbes. A wide range of effects so far have been found, such as tissue damage, reduced food intake, reduced growth, genetic effects, and also increased mortality. And these effects can have a large-scale implication on biodiversity and ecosystems, either by directly reducing species abundance or by indirectly affecting species which rely on those affected as food. So it's clear that they are a potential threat to biodiversity if allowed to continue to accumulate in the environment unchecked. The relationship between fibre fragments and climate change is less understood. We're earlier on in the journey, so understanding of these three areas is not all the same. And of course, you will all know very well that climate change refers to long-term shifts in temperatures and weather patterns that in the long run will completely alter the ecosystems that support life on Earth. The evidence to date is demonstrating that there are links between microplastics and climate change. Now, obviously, only microfibers that are released from synthetic textiles are microplastics. It's not yet known if or how natural microfibers are connected to climate change, but we do know that at least 30% of microplastics in the environment are from synthetic textiles, possibly much higher. And the evidence demonstrates that microplastics can affect marine organisms, coral reefs, and seagrass beds, and microbial communities in the ocean, which are essential for the ability for the ocean to act as a carbon sink, meaning there's more carbon in the atmosphere. And there is also evidence that demonstrates that microplastics can accelerate the release of greenhouse gases from soil. So as a community that is addressing fibre fragmentation and general sustainability agendas, we have the option and the opportunity here to come together as an industry to work towards an aligned manner in a collective way. Through understanding the mechanisms of fibre fragmentation and understanding the impact that they have, and drawing from the scientific evidence, we can find a way to deliver the change through strong, clear material strategies. If we come back to this infographic here, you'll see the box in the bottom centre, where that becomes an enabler to change the system. So if we can deliver that change through material strategies, and direct the action back through materials, whether through fabric research and development or manufacturing, we'll start to see a reduction in fibre fragmentation and its impact to the environment. It's fair to say we've come a long way. When we first put the Microfibre 2030 roadmap together back in 2021, our understanding was nowhere near what it is today. And it's clear that we need to shift gears as we move into the implementation stage of the roadmap, which is what we have moved in into 2024. TMC is currently revising the microfibre roadmap. And in doing that, one of the key aims of TMC, or priority, is integration of fibre fragmentation into mainstream sustainability agendas, moving from that niche to an integrated subject, not being out there on its own, but for organisations to fully embed and embrace it as a threat. In order to support you with this, we have a lot of tools and resources, most of which are freely available on our website. Fibre fragmentation cuts across pollution, biodiversity and climate. So all of our resources will feed into all three of these impact areas, but some resources particularly lend themselves to some particular areas, which are highlighted in this graphic by the white dots. Feel free to download them and use them and embed them within your organisations. You can download the QR codes here. Otherwise, feel free to visit our website. I'll put the link up in a moment that you can go to the resources page and download from there. So this is a call to action to you. I hope I have been able to demonstrate the impact the fibre fragmentation is having on the environment and why it is a topic that we should all care about. Go back and seed it within your organisations and your networks. Use the tools that we have developed and the evolving evidence that is out there to educate people who don't understand or know about this yet. Incorporate it within your strategies. The position and statement that TMC has recently released will help for guidance for implementing change within your organisation when it comes to material strategies and manufacturing. We have only learned by testing. Our testing of materials helps us form that root cause understanding that we have today that has come a long way since 2016. So test fabrics. If we can test them, if all of us test them together, scaling data makes that understanding much easier. Another area that we are hoping or plan to move into is how can we really connect these issues together? How is it that we can understand and bring together issues such as reducing fibre fragmentation from a material with climate change and in having a positive effect in that area? Are you doing anything in your material strategies that looks to positively impact climate change? By doing some of those processes and making those changes to the materials that you choose, is that also reducing fibre fragmentation? Are there positive effects to both? Can we move towards seeing this as a connective issue rather than one that just sits on the side? And we welcome you to collaborate with TMC by joining TMC and our collective community, or by joining our upcoming webinars, which are free for you to join on this particular topic. We have already launched the public webinar on environmental pollution that happened just last week, but the recording is available should you wish. Next time we will be digging deep into biodiversity and following on from that into climate change. In 2025, this is where we want to see the power of the collective us all coming together. How is it now we can see the evidence, the scientific evidence is there? How do we then move that together into the mainstream agenda? Further details on our website. The position and statement can be downloaded through the QR codes or can be accessed through our website too. And I would also encourage you to sign up to our newsletter and join us on LinkedIn so you can keep abreast of what is happening with TMC. So with that, I'd like to thank you. Open the floor to any questions that I'd be happy to take.
That's absolutely great. People might not know, but I have known Kelly since before you joined, going back to Don't Feed the Fish. My biggest reflection here is how much active progress there is, and as what the Microfibre Consortium has done better than anyone else is took progress. You've moved it forward. We've got from a sorting shop to now doing things. There is a wash test. There are routines. You've actually changed behavior within this industry of what is labeled to us one of the worst things that this industry has ever done for textiles. So I can only congratulate you on that. I've got some people in the audience here. Does anyone want to speak to Kelly directly? We have the first of the questions, Kelly.
Yay.
Hi, Kelly. This is Tom. Lovely to see you.
Hi.
First of all, appreciation moment for the Microfibre Consortium and working on such a complex phenomenon. Thank God you are there working on the topic. And you know how much I love working on the microfibers, doing lots of research, and recently I've been doing a lot of literature reviews about the articles which I've shared. And I just want to get your opinion from a scientific point of view. And one thing I realized when I was doing those research, there are field studies and there are a lot of studies. So in the field studies, when we think about the type of plastic, shape of plastic, and the size of the plastic, one thing I realized, the abundance in the nature is usually polyethylene, polypropylene, but I realized that lab studies, people are more focused on the polystyrene. And also for the shape of the microplastic, it's usually irregular in nature, but in the lab studies, you see that it's usually sphere type of things are used. And maybe for the sake of getting brief results, in the lab studies, concentration is also a little bit on a high end. So there are bad studies only giving high end concentrations, but there are also good studies comparing the lower end and the higher end. So the question is, can we really say today, can we come up with a decision that from an ecotoxicology point of view, that microfibers are really toxic? Or do we need to have more studies, especially in the terrestrial environment? Because we have more studies in the marine environment and specific types of animals. I just want to know your thoughts on this. Thank you.
Yes. Thanks, Carl. I think it's a great question. It's fair to say this is a journey. I think when we started, as I mentioned, back in 2016, we were talking about fiber fragments being an environmental pollutant and something that we should be concerned about. I think it's fair to say 8 years later, people generally accept that. You know, it's a much more established topic that people understand. The toxicological effects of them is at the start of that journey. So that you're right, there are lots of studies out there, but maybe they haven't been carried out using the most appropriate and relevant species, and that will come with time. I know that for sure when it comes to environmental pollution, for example. So a lot of studies that in the early days sampled the environment, the focus was plastics. So they went out to look for microplastics. And of course, if you only look for microplastics, you only find microplastics. It's become more clear to the community now that if all of the microfibers that you find are analyzed and characterized fully, the number of them that are non-synthetic outweigh the synthetic ones. But that is something that has been missed over the years because of the focus of the research studies. So research certainly has to evolve. Where I see TMC sitting is, and we have always sat, is in the centre between that deep academic research and the reality of the commercial supply chain. And I see that as a two-way thing. As much as we can take the scientific research that is coming out and help the industry to understand what that's saying, we also need to direct that backwards to tell the academic industry how to better perform studies so that we can really take away concrete conclusions from them as much as you can from a study. I think the more, as the body increases of research, that will only I guess it's not one study that's going to convince everybody, there needs to be a body of them, but as we start to refine the work that is being done, I do see that coming through. So what I would say in conclusion, Colin, to a bit of I could talk about this for a while. We are at the start of a journey. I think there is sufficient evidence that we should be worried. And we need to think about that no regrets approach. How much evidence is enough evidence before we start taking action? Because if we wait for all of the evidence to be there, my fear is it'll be too late.
That was a magnificently put answer. Now I'm going to ask a question that I don't want you to answer now. I will see you in California on Monday.
Okay.
But I think you guys have really got hold of the whole microfiber fragmentation going on. My concern, the next level up, is we now need to look at the toxic chemicals that are using the fibers as the carrier. But we're going to talk about that next week, because I know that if we start now, we'll be here for hours. What I'm trying to flag up is, because the Microfibre Consortium has started work, we're now progressing, we're advancing on better questions. And it's full respect to the people, I mean, you're in Newcastle, but you're essentially a virtual company, and they're in London. The progress you are making is enabling better conversations to happen. So my question to wrap this up, what's the biggest hurdle? What do you want my audience here to leave this session within their minds? What do you want them to do?
Embed it within your larger sustainability agenda. Do not see this issue as not part of the mainstream. As long as we put it on the side, it's not going to be addressed in the manner it needs to be addressed. And it's only through collective action that we can move it forward. I completely understand and appreciate that teams within brands and retailers have incredible pressure in trying to address so many different sustainability strategies and focuses. That's really, really challenging. We don't wish to add to that. We want it to be a part of it.
I am happy with that. I'm still looking around for if anyone wants the last question. Okay. Oh, we do. And it's going to be a very serious question. We have Mr. Rayburn.
And thank you for the presentation, Dr. Sheridan, really great. Very simple question, why is there no cheap, affordable, accessible, domestic, options for someone at home to connect to their washing machine or internet and kind of offer that, you know, the major source of microfiber plastic getting into water?
Thank you. It's a good question and one that I'm not going to fully answer. For me, I would challenge that isn't the major source. I think washing clothing, domestic washing of clothing, is where we started with the issue. It was where it was first highlighted. But there's enough evidence that demonstrates that water as a pathway is not the only pathway to the environment. I fear that other pathways will have a greater effect than washing clothing. So whilst developing a filter to put in a washing machine is part of a solution portfolio that we all need, it will not stop you, as you're sitting in your chair at the moment, leaving fibres from your clothes onto the seat that you're sat on. You picking fibres up from the seat that the person before sat on and moving them around the air. Fibres are lost from textiles as we are wearing them, as we are walking around, as we wash, as we dry. Whatever we are doing, we are shedding fibres. And so washing within a washing machine is part of the problem. The other thing that I think is vastly overlooked is that we think of this problem as the global north. 50% of the world doesn't own a washing machine. If people are washing their clothes through hand washing, either in buckets that is then being emptied into streams or directly in streams, how are we stopping that? So I think filtration is certainly part of a portfolio of solutions, but it is not the only one.
And this conversation can go on further. We're going to have to wrap this up, Kelly, because there are other things going on. Can I ask the audience to show our appreciation to Kelly, please? Kelly, thank you for continuing to go forward on this. It is raising the bar within the industry, laying out the challenge,